Hi, everyone, and welcome. Thanks for joining us here at Georgetown's Initiative on Catholic Social Thought and Public Life for the Lime Street Public Dialogue on the Pro-Life Movement at a Crossroads, Dobbs and a Divided Society. This is our first dialogue in 2022. Last year, we held 20 dialogues reaching over 56,000 people, and we look forward to more of these in the year to come. We're so grateful to have so many of you joining us today from around the country and even internationally, with more than 1,800 registered in advance for our conversation. Now, this coming Saturday marks the 49th anniversary of the Roe v. Wade decision legalizing abortion in all 50 states. The annual March for Life will take place this coming Friday. And this spring, the U.S. Supreme Court will decide Dobbs v. Jackson Women's Health Organization, the most important abortion case in decades. And the court could overturn Roe and related cases. For 50 years, this issue has haunted our nation, dividing Americans and poisoning our politics, even as prenatal children have been denied protection and justice, while women facing unexpected pregnancies are left without the public, social, and material resources that an authentic culture of life would provide. Catholic principles call for a consistent ethic of life and just laws that protect and promote the life and dignity of each and every person, especially the poor and vulnerable, and regardless of age or stage in life, ability, immigration status, race, religion, gender, or any other factor. At this watershed moment in our nation's approach to abortion, today we've brought together leaders within the pro-life community to discuss its successes and failures, the challenges and opportunities it faces, and what the future might hold. We'll set the context by briefly exploring the history of the pro-life movement, and then we'll turn to the current context, including former President Trump's embrace of the pro-life movement and his judicial appointments, as well as his continued and destabilizing refusal to accept the results of the 2020 election and the violent attack on the U.S. Capitol just a little over a year ago. Our context is also defined by the Biden administration's policies, including its embrace of the abortion rights movement's agenda, and including policies that undermine longstanding protections like the Hyde Amendment, as well as the president's support, on the other hand, for an expanded child tax credit and other important help for families. Finally, we'll discuss how we can work together to ensure that every child is protected in law and welcomed in life, and that women are respected and supported. Too often what divides us are not just legal or moral perspectives, but where we focus our energy, on the lives and dignity of unborn children or on women in need facing an unexpected pregnancy. Today, we'll ask how we can focus on the lives and dignity of both. We've brought together a remarkable group of leaders for this conversation. Erica Bakayoki is a legal scholar specializing in equal protection jurisprudence, feminist legal theory, Catholic social teaching, and sexual ethics. She's a fellow at the Ethics and Public Policy Center and a senior fellow at the Abigail Adams Institute. And her latest book is The Rights of Women, Reclaiming a Lost Vision. Destiny Herndon-De is the president and founder of New Wave Feminists, a consistent life ethic women's rights organization. NWF's activism is rooted in building bridges so that communities can serve women, children, and families better. They work throughout the U.S. and are currently building a shelter in Juarez, Mexico, to provide care and support for pregnant migrant mothers at the border. Gloria Purvis is the host of the Gloria Purvis podcast at American Media. She's a consultant to the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops Committee on Religious Liberty, and she served on the National Black Catholic Congress Commission on Social Justice, the Maryland Catholic Conference's Respect for Life Advisory Board, and the Pastoral Council for the Archdiocese of Washington. And Dan Williams is a professor of history at the University of West Georgia, where his research focuses on the intersection of politics and religion in modern America. He's the author of The Leading History of the Pro-Life Movement, Defenders of the Unborn, the Pro-Life Movement at a Crossroads, the Pro-Life Movement Before Roe v. Wade, as well as The Politics of the Cross, a Christian Alternative to Partisanship. Thanks to all of you who are joining us on YouTube and Twitter, and please share your thoughts on social media using the hashtag ProLifeCrossroads and by tagging the initiative at GUCST Public Life. We'll also have an opportunity for questions and answers later on, so please submit questions for the panelists by following the prompts at the bottom of the screen. This dialogue is being recorded and will be posted on our website and social channels for later viewing. So now let's start the conversation. I'd like to ask each of you in turn to answer an opening question. Erica, let's start with you. At this watershed moment in our nation's approach to abortion, what are the most important challenges and opportunities facing the pro-life movement?
Yeah, thanks for having me. It's really wonderful to be with you all. So I guess I think that the greatest opportunity we face as a pro-life movement really is our greatest challenge as well. And that is, I think, convincing those legislators who have been really heroic in voting for judges to overturn Roe and Casey to see the critical importance of a robust family policy in support of women, children, and their families. This is obviously very important in red and purple states moving forward, but also among Republicans in Congress. I think we're seeing really creative pro-family policies being advanced by some on the right, like the likes of Republicans Mitt Romney and Marco Rubio, but we really need far more of this among those legislators who call themselves pro-life. Now, of course, pro-lifers have much to do in blue states like mine, Massachusetts, and in the Democratic caucus as well. But I personally gave up on the pro-life cause among Democrats some time ago, so I'll have to leave that to the rest of you.
Thanks, Erica. Let's turn to you, Dan. What do you think are the most important challenges and opportunities for the pro-life movement?
Well, I would echo some of what Erica said. I think it's important to note that if the Supreme Court rescinds Roe v. Wade in a ruling later this term, it's certainly going to be a momentous event, but it will not mean the end of legal abortion in the United States. Instead, it's going to mean the acceleration of current trends that are already ongoing, meaning a greater divide between Republican-dominated states, Democratic-dominated states in their policies on abortion. And so even as a number of states move toward more restrictive policies, we can expect that other states will move toward more permissive policies, making abortion more available, not only for women in those states, but for women who want to cross state lines to have an abortion. In fact, if the 16 Southern and Midwestern states that are likely to restrict abortion if they're legally allowed to do so, close all of the clinics in their states, those 16 Southern and Midwestern and Great Plains states still would not equal the total number of abortion clinics that remain open in New York. So given that reality, we need to talk not only about rescinding Roe v. Wade, but about creating a culture of life that will empower lower income women, especially who are facing crisis pregnancies, to make the choices that will enable them to keep their babies and raise them in a society in which their families will have the food and healthcare and other resources that they need to thrive and succeed. And so in other words, we need a pro-life strategy that will work not only in Mississippi and North Dakota, but also in places like New York and California, and in the entire Northeast and Pacific West Coast. That is a strategy that will work toward a culture of life, whether abortion is legal or illegal, and finds ways to act creatively in ways that I think, as I'll explain later, channel those early impulses of the pro-life movement that began well before Roe v. Wade.
We're looking forward to hearing more about that. Destiny, let's go to you just to help open up the conversation. What do you think are the most important challenges and opportunities for the pro-life movement from where you sit?
Yeah, I would say as somebody who kind of, I tend to work outside of the political realm. So my organization, our focus has never been on the legality of abortion as much as how do we create a post-Roe culture now? You know, we've had 49 years to put this infrastructure together and we've certainly made attempts, but it needs to be done much more on a micro level. And so how can we in our communities create the safety nets that women need, no matter what's going on in Washington or even on, you know, federal levels? How do we as individuals look at the woman in front of us and say, what is causing her to consider abortion in the first place, right? It's not enough to just address the supply side. We have to address demand. What is it that is driving women to this and where can we as individuals meet those needs? So I think the biggest thing facing us right now is, you know, if Roe is overturned, are there people who are going to pat themselves on the back and say job well done and go home and stop? Or are we going to see the necessity to not only keep loving women, but love them even better, no matter what the laws are in their states or in our nation.
That's great. And I want to come back to that idea of building a pro-life culture in our communities post-Roe, should that happen. Gloria, let's end up this first part of our conversation with you. What do you see as the major challenges, opportunities facing the pro-life movement right now?
One of the major challenges for the pro-life community, I'm looking at this from the perspective of somebody that actively works in the Black community on pro-life issues. And one of the major challenges the pro-life community has is its inability to really be attractive to African-Americans. And I think there, because of some of, I would say it's like, there seems to be a disconnect in accepting this idea that a person has dignity from conception until a natural death. And we saw that come out in recently with George Floyd and some reactions from prominent pro-lifers to his murder and to the conviction of the officer that murdered him that seemed to betray our own pro-life values. And so I think with those kinds of witnesses and also how the movement and to some people is perceived as only caring about Black people in the womb and then outside the womb really championing policies that are contrary to the thriving of the Black community. So I think we have to really look at that and call out those within our movement that are given this counter witness. And we have to be sensitive to it, that racism does exist, not just in the womb with abortion, but outside the womb as well. And we can't be seen as enemies to those movements that are dealing with issues of racism. We can be both pro-life and for racial justice. They are twin sisters. They're not enemies. And that's a big challenge for the pro-life movement. We need to, I think, also decouple the movement from being seen as strictly politically conservative, because those words for some communities mean racist. Okay. And we need to help people understand that we are not that. And we need to call out those leaders in our movement who have done and seem to perpetuate things that are contrary to our pro-life values. We need to invite everybody to conversion here to understand that be pro-life really does mean we care about the human person from conception till natural death, no matter what. No matter if they're likable, no matter if they're criminal, no matter if they're drug addicts, whatever. People say somebody is on the margins of society, no matter what, they have dignity. And we are going to defend that person's life, right to life and a right to a natural death.
Thanks so much. And I think that should be an important part of our conversation today, is this idea of calling out counter witness and what that means here. So I'm looking forward to taking that conversation further. But right now, let's go back to you, Dan. And I want to take a step back and put all of this in context. Your work focuses on the intersection of religion and politics in modern America, and your book, Defenders of the Unborn, is an intellectual and political history of the pro-life movement. And it's been praised by people on all sides of this issue. There's just so much for us to learn here. Please tell us, and I know we only have a few minutes, but could you tell us about the early pre-Roe history of the movement as a progressive human rights campaign and how it changed after Roe and how that should help us rethink where we are now and where we should go?
Sure. That's a great question. And you're right. There's a lot to unpack there. And I'll try to do my best in just a couple minutes. I would begin by saying that the majority of the early pro-life advocates from the late 1930s through the early 1970s were New Deal Democrats or Great Society liberals who believed that protecting the unborn was a human rights cause, but it was part of a larger comprehensive vision for society, a comprehensive vision that included care for people after birth, all the way until natural death, as well as, of course, before birth. So as an example of that, for instance, in 1947, the National Catholic Welfare Conference issued its own Declaration of Human Rights as a model for the United Nations, and it began with the right to life from the moment of conception, but then it continued with other rights, like the right to a living wage, the right to education, the right to assistance from society. And so in keeping with this theme, when the first pro-life organizations emerged in the mid-1960s and early 1970s, they often linked their activism against abortion with efforts to reduce poverty or to speak out against the Vietnam War. And so as one example of this, immediately before Roe v. Wade, on January 11th, 1973, the North Dakota Right to Life Association held a pro-life conference that included panels like health insurance for unwed mothers and subsidized adoption, because those were the issues that they wanted to talk about in conjunction with efforts to restrict abortion. In fact, at that moment, North Dakota pro-lifers had just won a major victory with a referendum that was defeated at the polls that would have legalized abortion in the state in November 1972, but was not. And so coming fresh off this victory, the question was, what next? And North Dakota Right to Lifers said, well, what's next, of course, is trying to envision this just and caring society. But Roe v. Wade, of course, was an unexpected blow to the pro-life movement. It reoriented the movement's priorities. nearly all pro-life organizations, whether on the left or the moderate center, made a constitutional amendment protecting the unborn their highest priority. And when they couldn't get that, and it became apparent in the mid-1980s that they were not going to be able to get that constitutional amendment, the question was, what then? And so they turned to a judicial strategy to try to rescind Roe v. Wade through the Supreme Court. And now, after some nearly 40 years of that strategy, 35 years at least, it looks like there's a chance it might pay off. But if it does pay off, I think it's important to remember that this was not what the pro-life movement was originally founded on. It was not their original priority. It was just one strategy in an intervening era when nothing else seemed possible. And so if we're going to ask the question, what can we rediscover from the pro-life movement's early history? I think it's important to realize that comprehensive social justice vision and the place that protection for the unborn played in this comprehensive vision, but it was never the entirety of the vision. It was the foundation of it.
That's really interesting. And let me push a little bit on that here with us. I wonder if you could, you study religion and politics and their intersection today in modern America. I wonder if you could talk practically about the bitter division that we face on this issue and how we might actually move forward on these policies. Because on the one hand, it seems to me there's no room for pro-life people in the Democratic Party. On the other hand, we have a Republican Party that has been radicalized, that is obstructionist in many ways. Do you see a path forward for work together on some of these policies that I hear many of us on this call advocating for?
Yeah, I do. I think it's going to require, though, a reexamination of what it means to be pro-life or to be opposed to abortion. So if we define pro-life as meaning that we want conservative justices who will vote to rescind Roe v. Wade, then that of necessity requires cooperation only with the Republican Party, because almost no Democrats are going to vote for the sort of justices that would overturn Roe. In fact, in the latest Supreme Court nomination fight, there were no Democrats that voted to confirm someone that was viewed as a pro-life justice. So that's one approach, to simply say, well, we'll put more Republicans in. But on the other hand, if being pro-life means something other than merely striving for the end of Roe v. Wade, as desirable as that might be, if it also means efforts to reduce the abortion rate, efforts to honor human life in every form, then Medicaid expansions at the state level, which some of the state legislatures, including Mississippi, by the way, that are viewed as most pro-life, are most reluctant to do, then that may well mean reaching across the aisle and working with people who are viewed as pro-choice, but whose policies may actually help to reduce the abortion rate or empower women to make choices that would provide for unborn children that they fear they don't have the resources to bring into the world. So I do think that there's room to work with Democrats and Republicans, but in order to do that, we have to depoliticize the conversation by reimagining what it means to be pro-life.
Of course, and that's wonderful. And I also want to be sure to highlight the work of groups like Democrats for Life of America, people like Katrina Jackson in Louisiana and others. And I hope there is room for us to work across the aisle. But now I want to turn to you, Erica. I want you to, if you could, help us set the legal and policy context for us here. You're a legal scholar. You're an expert in equal protection and abortion law. And in fact, you filed an amicus brief in the Dobbs case. Help us understand this context. So what's the current status quo right now on abortion? Is it likely that Roe will be overturned here? And if so, what happens next? And I'd also love to hear from you a little bit about how other nations approach this issue, which is so divisive for us here in the U.S.
Yeah, so I guess as our viewers undoubtedly know, and as you explained at the outset, just last month, the Supreme Court heard oral arguments in the case Dobbs v. Jackson. So under review in that case is basically the constitutionality of a Mississippi ban on most abortions after 15 weeks. And what's really important to point out about this Mississippi law is how moderate it is. So most other nations, including nearly all of Europe, protect unborn children beginning at about 10 to 12 weeks of development. So the trouble, of course, is that the Supreme Court cases that govern abortion law in our country, Roe v. Wade and Planned Parenthood versus Casey do not allow prohibitions on abortion anytime before viability, which is currently around 20 weeks. So for this 15-week Mississippi law to stand, again, very moderate law, Roe and Casey actually have to go, which is why, again, you know, Dan's talking about how, you know, laser focused the pro-life movement has been on Roe because it doesn't even allow these kind of moderate laws. So there's this outside possibility that in June, when the case comes down and is decided, the justices could have fashioned some sort of compromise. But I think for a number of reasons, it's likely that Roe and Casey will be overturned in late June. So what does all of this mean? Again, I think most people know, but just to kind of put a fine point on it, the Supreme Court will still review abortion laws with Roe and Casey overturned, but just with a standard that is far more deferential to legislators. So this would allow states and theoretically Congress to basically design laws that are far more protective of unborn children, as legislatures are able to do in the rest of the world. But of course, if we're going to do away with this really permissive kind of libertarian abortion law, then we also ought to be doing, and this is, you know, what we've all been talking about, what those other nations also do that we do not, and that is provide far more generous economic supports for women and their families. You know, we have this just basic like libertarian orientation in our law, and we really need, as a corrective to that, not only sort of a more solidaristic account for the child in the womb, but also for women, for their families, to sort of see that we're all in this together. And Europe does just a much better job of that.
Just want to stay with you for one more minute, because I want to talk about your latest book, The Rights of Women, and where you propose a feminism shaped by our responsibilities towards one another. And you've said that the widespread availability of abortion gives us almost an excuse to ignore our shared responsibilities to women and children, and in fact, has harmed women. I want to just say, we're already getting questions like this, right? This is counterintuitive to many, particularly many women who believe that what they view as reproductive freedom is a matter of justice and is essential to how they structure their lives. So how do you respond to those who believe that support for unrestricted abortion is a fundamental right and priority for women? And what policies do you advocate to help ensure that women facing unexpected pregnancies might get that material and social support? And the basis of the question I think I'm hearing is, how can you replace constitutional guarantees for legal abortion with more help for women and children? Isn't there something else fundamental here at stake?
I think we need an entire like reorientation, sort of philosophical orientation. And I actually think the earliest women's rights advocates help with that kind of communitarian, dignitarian vision. And I actually, just to sort of answer your question more simply than just sort of throwing my entire book there, I actually really, really like the language that's, you know, the pro-choice movement use in recent decades of reproductive justice. I actually think it's really, really helpful to kind of thinking this through kind of anew, because the virtue of justice basically demands that we give to each what he or she is due, right? What he or she is owed by virtue of a particular relation with them, or just their status as a human being. So I think if we to think better about what we owe one another can really help us kind of re-knit our obligations to one another, which is something that our very libertarian country, kind of on both left and right, are kind of like, leave me alone with my rights kind of country, really needs, I think, very badly right now. But when we think about kind of what a politics of solidarity or even kind of a solidaristic feminism would look like, we really need to start with what we owe the most vulnerable and dependent of human beings and then kind of work outward. So just structurally, we need to first ask kind of what is the unborn child due? And so the kind of immediate obvious answer is, well, the care and nurture only her mother can give her. But then what is that mother do? What does the woman do? And of course, then we can start to sort of talk about those things. Well, care and nurture and support, I think first we have to go to the father of the child, which is, of course, he's equally responsible for the child's existence, right? But also then robust support from the wider community. And these obligations really work inexplicably, kind of inescapably together. And we can talk sort of why that may be the case. But I think to really see a thoroughgoing kind of pro-life solidaristic ethic, we need to see the obligations of the family as first and then rewire the workplace to support the family's culturally essential work.
Thanks so much. Thanks so much for that background. And I know we'll get into these questions more later on. Destiny, let's turn to you now. You come at these issues with the perspective of a young activist and the founder of New Wave Feminists. You work for consistent nonviolence from the womb to the tomb at your group. How did you come to do this work and to found New Wave Feminists? Can you tell us about your experience on the national stage and about your work with women in need?
It's rooted in a very personal experience with my own mother becoming pregnant with me when she was 19 years old at the University of Texas in Austin. And, I know that I could have easily been aborted. A lot of people probably thought that would have been the responsible choice so she could continue her education. But my family is rooted very much in like scientific pro-life. Like I remember we had the copy of the Life magazine with all of the photos of life inside the womb. And so she knew this isn't a clump of cells, this is a human being, and ended up having to sacrifice her education, move back home with my grandparents up here in Dallas. And, you know, it was kind of a tumultuous decade while she finished her education, got her degree. We experienced poverty, you know, all of these things that are given as reasons for why she should have had an abortion, but she understood my human dignity from the moment I first existed. And so it's funny because people ask all the time, you know, are you more pro-life or more feminist? And I'm both together for the exact same reasons, because the belief that, women are not property, should have never been treated as property, but were treated as property for millennia. And then through us gaining rights and liberations and our strength and privilege in society now, we can't pass down that same patriarchal oppression onto another human being and say, they're just property. We can use violence against them because they don't have the status or privilege that we have. And so as has been talked about, you know, focusing on the marginalized and the people who have these very real life experiences, a lot of times it does become a very political kind of conversation. But I think the more we get it back to just a human level, this is a human rights issue. This is something where we do need to be looking at the mother and the child to make sure that we are stepping up to create this culture of life. Because then in my own experience at 16, I ended up facing an unplanned pregnancy, and nobody could have been more upset with me than I was at myself in that moment. Here I was repeating the cycle. I knew how hard it was to be the fetus in this scenario. And now I was the scared pregnant teenager. But when you have a support system, it changes everything. So there was still desperation. There was a very real moment of, I want to rip my womb off my body and run away from it. And it is terrifying. And you are in this cloud of chaos. But at the same time, having that calm in the storm and a family saying, I'm not kicking you out. We have health insurance. You know, these are the things we have that can make this possible for you to choose life. That's the very practical, real reason that I now have a 21-year-old and that I'm now here, because my mother had that support. And so I think that's why New Wave Feminists we're more oriented to just, there are so many women who didn't have these, you know, privileges that I had, and they were peers of mine, and they were choosing abortion. And I use that term very loosely, because many of them were going to be kicked out of their home, and they had all these societal kind of coercions going along with it. I do not want them to be lacking and be forced into a choice that's not a choice, because we don't have these same systems in place. And so that's definitely what New Wave Feminist focuses on quite a bit.
Thanks so much for sharing that, Destiny. We really appreciate it. And I know that it'll inform the rest of our conversation as we go forward. I wonder if I could point to something else that you've written. You've said that consistency matters. The most dangerous thing we ever did as a nation was make abortion a partisan issue, because it's allowed anyone with an R behind their name to activate a powerhouse base of voters simply by applying the label pro-life. Can you talk a little bit about that, about why consistency matters? And also maybe I'll give us some non-religious reasons why you are pro-life.
Yeah, well, so I personally am agnostic. I'm independent, so I don't really fit into any of these political systems. But for a really long time, I did tend to vote Republican, because chronologically, the right to life is the first right. And I saw so many politicians who would give us lip service, but not actually deliver. And so when I would be, you know, doing sidewalk counseling outside of an abortion clinic, and not in a crazy way, in a, you know, hey, there's other options for you, there's other choices, one of the first things we would do is help women access Medicaid, get them a proof of pregnancy, get them sonograms, real resources. And then the very politicians who we were supposed to be supporting because they were pro-life would turn around and start cutting at these support systems that made it possible for women to choose life. And so for me personally, the disillusionment of, you know, the government's going to save us. No, we're going to save ourselves. You know, at the end of the day, as Dan said, this has to be a cultural shift in consciousness. This cannot be one with one political party, one religious group, right? It has to be all of us understanding the humanity of the unborn. And so we often say, we're not necessarily, our focus isn't on making abortion illegal as much as it's on making it unnecessary and unthinkable. And you do that through resourcing women so well that it's unnecessary and making it unthinkable by humanizing the child in the womb so well. But that humanization has to go further. It goes into the, you know, looking at incarceration rates, looking at the infant maternal mortality among women of color, especially, and racial bias in the medical community. You know, the way we're treating migrant mothers, especially. And this humanization, it doesn't have to just be kept on the abortion issue. I think a lot of people think it's a zero-sum game. We have to put all of our focus here. I found that the more we focus on the bigger consistent life ethic and understanding the dignity of all humans and protecting all humans from violence, the more it actually adds credibility to our heart for the unborn child in the womb. So I loved what he said about, you know, this is the foundation, right? And that's the way we need to be looking at it.
Excellent. And I want to return to that question of credibility in a little while too. Thanks so much. Gloria, let's go to you now. You're a longtime pro-life leader. You're an advisor to the U.S. bishops, and you've been a highly successful Catholic commentator, most recently at American Media as the host of the Gloria Purvis podcast. And it's a terrific episode, by the way, today, and why the pro-life movement struggles to reach Black people. And I encourage all of you to listen to it. Can you tell us a little bit about why the consistent ethic of life is important to you and how the Catholic community in particular should be approaching life issues today, how it should be preparing for the possible overturning of Roe versus Wade?
So the consistent life ethic to me, just especially as a Catholic, just means that I value life from its beginning to its end, because I understand each and every person is made in the image and likeness of God. And because that they have a worth that just an incomparable worth, right? And dignity. And they're also my family, because we have a common ancestor, God. And so we are all brothers and sisters. And because I love God and because I love my neighbor and because I love my family, I have obligations to other people in this world. And it's an obligation that I don't find oppressive, because in my heart, I love who they are. And I love that they are made in his image and likeness. And I try to find the beauty in every person. And I have hope about every person. But it seems like in the movement, I will say, I think, because we talk about the innocence of the child in the womb, that sometimes people then say, well, this person's not innocent. And therefore, there's a cloud around their dignity and what they are owed. And I think that's a problem. For the Catholic community, I think for the things that we already have in place, we just are going to need to have more robust programs in place. You can look from diocese to diocese at the pro-life office and see what they have to offer to women. And I know the secretariat of at the USCCB, the pro-life secretariat, has a Walking with Moms program that is basically going to aggregate everything, all the resources that are available by diocese for all women in crisis pregnancies, so that if someone needs help, we have a database to show them, okay, where are you? Here, this is where you can get help. But we're going to need more of that. And I also think we cannot give up on the legal part as well. Again, the movement, it's both and. It's the material support, and we do have to do the legal part of overturning abortion. We understand that it's a choice that some people are coerced into or choose out of desperation. And some people choose because they understand that there's a lot of stigma being an unmarried woman with a child. I was very much appalled at some conversation publicly that some pro-lifers had around a chart that seemed to portray poor Black women having the highest number of out of wedlock births. And instead of these people who say they're pro-life, instead of these people actually saying, you know what, this shows that Black women are choosing life, even in difficult circumstances, they said, see, there's something wrong with that Black culture. There's something wrong with Black people. That's wrong. What's wrong with their community? And I thought, this is contrary to what we as pro-life believe. We need to actually have some consistency on the issue, and we cannot let
political talking points that want to undermine our obligation to do something about racism be the lead. That just has to, we have to challenge that. And I think that is going to be a problem for the movement. The how do we challenge the political talking heads who seem to be helping us in terms of overturning the legality of abortion, while at the same time they're creating a culture that is completely the opposite of embracing the dignity of the human person. So we have to be able to walk that walk and do that work.
Thanks so much for that, Gloria. I really appreciate it. I also want to obviously note that yesterday was Martin Luther King Day. I'd love for you to take just a minute to help us bring Dr. King's message of racial justice and nonviolence into this conversation. Where does violence happen? How can we resist it? How should we be looking to his model for engagement with American public life?
Oh my gosh, thank you. And on my podcast, I actually spoke with his daughter, Dr. Bernice King, about her father's legacy a few episodes ago. But I'm so glad you bring this up because I think Martin Luther King today is largely misunderstood about racial justice. People do not understand what he meant when he talked about color blindness. I think that has been used a lot to undermine the work that is integral to any justice movement. And so we need to revisit authentically what Dr. King said and the challenges he laid out for us about racism. I mean, he talked about the fact that we need to be willing to, as a matter of justice, when we have more, understand that those who have less are owed the excess that we have, right? And that is also in the case of racial justice. There's so much we can learn from Dr. King there. And also his approach to nonviolence takes a lot of self-mastery, actually. I think that's one of the things that we need to think about. It's not some easy sort of to in the face of injustice, in the face of people violently attacking you, to choose love, to choose nonviolence, to choose reason, you know, is a very difficult thing when our response might be to punch, you know, somebody. So we have to really think about that nonviolence is a good tool in the movement. And when there are people that riot or whatever it is, he says it's the language of the unheard. And we need to focus on what is it that is causing them to riot rather than condemning them because they riot. And then lastly, let me say this. We have to remember that abortion is an act of violence against the woman and the prenatal child. And that fundamentally is against justice when we're using our own strength to destroy life in the womb and by extension also destroy the women. So, you know, I'm glad you brought up Dr. King. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for that. And I love that this conversation is focusing on issues of justice, issues of nonviolence, issues of a consistent ethic of life. We're getting a lot of questions in, and I'd like to sort of open it up to everybody now. Maybe Dan, I'll start with you. On the one hand, without former President Trump's Supreme Court nominees, we arguably wouldn't be discussing the potential overturning of Roe. But at what cost did that come after his attempt to steal the 2020 election, continued efforts to undermine democratic institutions, the violent attack on the Capitol? What kind of soul searching do you think the pro-life movement should be going through, if any? Did he help or hurt this effort? Start with you and then go to others.
Yeah, there's no question that President Trump was the key to getting a more conservative Supreme Court that would overturn Roe v. Wade potentially. So we would not be having this exact conversation today had the 2016 election turned out differently. On the other hand, we have to ask the question, as you suggested in that in your query, at what cost? The cost, I think, is that the pro-life movement is now more firmly identified with a Republican Party that a number of people who were not part of it, who were very skeptical of Trump, view as dangerous to American democracy. Certainly, there were many Democrats who were strongly opposed to President George W. Bush or earlier Republicans. But the degree of concern about where the Republican Party is taking this country is now considerably greater than it was even a decade ago. And if the pro-life movement is associated very closely with the Republican Party, as I fear that in many people's minds it is, then it's going to be very hard to convince people who are skeptical of the movement anyway that this is a movement that cares about justice, this is a movement that cares about women, this is a movement that cares about the greater social good. And I'm mindful of the fact that the early pro-lifers were opposed to utilitarian arguments that were contributing to the movement toward liberalization of abortion laws. People who said, well, we understand that abortion is morally problematic, but we're going to achieve a greater social good by doing this. And so I would say our contemporary pro-lifers guilty of a similar utilitarianism in saying, well, we're concerned about President Trump. We're concerned about January 6th. We're concerned about a number of things. We're concerned about his past treatment of women, but look at the Supreme Court justices. And I would say, has the pro-life movement inadvertently engaged in some utilitarian thinking that will ultimately tarnish the movement's moral reputation?
Erica, why don't we go to you with that same question? You had a piece in the New York Times that the New York Times titled that you didn't vote for Trump, but that you were grateful for his Supreme Court picks. Can you react to what Dan has said and the question that came from the audience?
Yeah, no, I pretty much agree with everything that Dan has said. And I guess I would say a couple of things, being the lawyer on the panel, that I just would agree with what Gloria said about how important the law is. And so if you sort of take this in kind of the two steps that were necessary, and we're at the very beginning, right? But that law is one of sort of our best and most important educators. And so when you push back, when you have the possibility of even the possibility of allowing legislatures to pass laws that are more protective of unborn children, I think that it can kind of reset the culture so that people, when they're engaging in sexual activity, which again, of course, which is the obvious, you know, thing, the precursor to having an unexpected pregnancy, that they can kind of start to take more seriously that consequence that is really an asymmetrical one for women, and really take more seriously the responsibilities they have with regard to sex. And I think I'm thinking of sort of irresponsible men first and foremost. For that reason, for that very reason, before, you know, right around the time of Trump's inauguration, when I couldn't vote for him either time, but I did write on CNN how he was sort of the worst possible representative of the pro-life movement because of the way in which he spoke about and had treated women. Because I think it, you know, in that way, abortion kind of opens the floodgates to that sort of sexual kind of prerogative that men take on themselves because, hey, you know, you can just go get an abortion. So I think there's this massive tension. But of course, you need the law to educate, to enable these laws to be passed in order to get there. So it's like this essential step that needs to be taken. Is there utilitarian thinking? Yes. And there were those pro-lifers who had to make that judgment that I, as a Massachusetts pro-lifer, really didn't, because there was a possibility of Trump taking my state. The other thing that I talked about in my New York Times piece that I think is really important is just the way in which Trump, in his kind of awful way, was able to kind of, yes, he's done lots of things to make the Republican Party or many of the Republican leaders really callous and coarse in their way of speech, which I find really awful. But in another way, he also brought about this kind of push away from a libertarian economic position that I think is really, really important for the poor, for the working classes, for women who face unexpected pregnancy. So I think there's, again, this massive tension. Like, the way I see it is, you know, I didn't vote for him, but he was elected. He's done these things. January 6th happened. And so what can we take from now? Certainly the decoupling of the movement with Trump. Let's hope he, you know, doesn't sit in that White House again. Let's hope he doesn't run again. But I do think there, we kind of just sort of have to see the silver linings and work with the ways in which he's pushed many in the GOP, I think. I mean, there are some who, you know, were very much on the kind of, I mean, think of Mitt Romney himself, who was like the, you know, all about sort of, you know, the tax cuts, et cetera. And then suddenly has this one of the most robust family policies that has been put out by either party. So I guess I would want to just see where we go from here and just and try to work with those Republicans who have made a lot of gains in seeing how important it is to have that family policy corrective of our libertarian orientation.
Gloria, let me just take that question to you very quickly. Your reaction to what you've heard so far in this question, and maybe in particular on this last point of Erica's, you know, we've seen, you know, do you agree that President Trump, former President Trump, took policies in a more libertarian, a less libertarian direction, economic policies? Like, are we going to see policies, rubber hit the road? We're going to see actual family-friendly policies or not? Your reaction to what you've heard.
We have to start to see them if people want to have credibility about saying that they are pro-life. I mean, I think we need to push people on that. I think we really, really need to do. And I think we also need to challenge those in the Democratic Party who say they are champions of women and help them understand that abortion actually upholds systems of oppression for women and that we haven't gone far enough in our culture to make the right kind of changes in business, even to make it a place that's accommodating, that's welcoming to women who are pregnant and mothering. Our culture is not there yet at all. And so I think we have a lot of conversations to have. And I agree with Erica that abortion does facilitate the kind of Lothario behavior among men that Trump did exemplify in his personal life. And sometimes I wonder, was it a Pyrrhic victory having Trump elected, you know, from a pro-life perspective? I was like, but we do have this in the court. We now have Dobbs that is going in front of the court. But what did we lose? And how can we regain what we lost by having that person as the champion? And how do we realize that, look, we can have someone that a transactional relationship with a politician says, I'll do this if you vote for me. But then at the same time, when he's undermining the very values that we have about the human person, I think we have a duty to speak out, right? And so it is a tension. It is a tension, but we can't let temporal power make us lose our values. So we still had to hold him accountable, I think, as well.
Thanks for that. And by the way, we're getting a lot of questions in. And so we've just shifted to answering questions from the audience, and we welcome your questions. So please feel free to follow the prompts at the bottom of your screen. And hopefully we'll get to as many as we can. Destiny, I want to turn to you with all this. First of all, reaction to anything you've heard so far. Also, we're getting questions about your group's participation or lack of participation in the Women's March. If you could talk about that a little bit. And then I'm going to come back to you with a question after that as well, about what we talk about when we talk about feminism here. So first, let's talk a little bit about your experience with the march and your reaction to anything you've heard here.
Yeah. So we actually did participate in the Women's March, not from a sponsorship level. Obviously, we were removed. And the best thing about that is it created this kind of national conversation for about 2 weeks prior. Should feminists be allowed to be pro-life, which is kind of an ironic conversation when you think about the fact that feminism is rooted in rebellion and saying, like, we're not going to, you know, settle for the status quo. We're going to think outside of the box. And so much of, I think there was some confusion, you know, are they really feminists or are they just pro-lifers co-opting and, you know, using this word? And hopefully by now people understand that we absolutely are true feminists. And when it came to the Women's March, you know, we agreed, we agreed with so much of what was being said. And so when we're hearing from these leaders in the racial justice movement and people talking about immigration, these things that we're very passionate and care about, you know, we would clap along with that. And then somebody would come up and talk about abortion and we would kind of stand silently. But we've actually become pros at this, being not conservatives either, and going to things like the March for Life. You know, there are times where I clap along with things I agree with, but things that I disagree with from even that platform that's very, you know, GOP oriented and maybe out of line with what we agree with, we stand there respectfully and silently. And I think that is something that I wish I saw more people do, right? You don't have to be complete in lock and step with a political party in these platforms that maybe you don't agree with. And so it is okay to say, I agree with this stuff you're doing, it's good, but maybe not everything. And so when we went to the Women's March, it was actually beautiful. I had a woman come up to me with a Planned Parenthood beanie on and a scarf and the big Planned Parenthood sign. And she was probably in her 70s, which tend to be the feminists that, you know, don't like us the most because they're the ones who were out there marching for Roe, right? And so she walks up and she puts her finger in my face and she's like, I think it's wrong. And I was like, this lady might be about to hit me. And then she finishes it and she goes, that you were kicked out of this march. You're a woman. You deserve to be here as much as anyone else. And it was like this M. Night Shyamalan type twist that I could not have even seen coming. And I was like, that's amazing. So it's maybe the powers that be for optics reasons felt the need to remove us as sponsors, but the actual women there that we saw were incredibly kind to us. And they got it because at the end of the day, you know, they say they're not pro-abortion, they're pro-choice. If that's true, then we need to be challenging them because all we see you working towards is abortion access and abortion funding. What are you doing to help the woman who chooses parenting, who makes a life-affirming decision? Because you can come alongside us and help us help these women. And I think we're starting to see a rise in people who get that and say, okay, you know, no matter what happens with Roe, maybe we do need to make alliances and work together to support women because there are other choices besides abortion.
Thanks so much for that. And I just want to come back to you with a question because I've got a couple of questions like this. I'm going to try to put it together and I want to be sure to do it justice. But we have people asking rightly, how do we talk about, you know, don't dodge the issue of fundamental rights for women to bodily autonomy. And that doesn't mean autonomy writ large. It means a very difficult question of what's going on here. Can we talk about feminism when we talk about what is ultimately that kind of a limit on what many see as a fundamental right? And how can we replace constitutional guarantees of legal abortion, is the way the question is phrased, with more help for women who are pregnant? Those two things aren't the same. Can you speak to that? And then maybe Erica.
Yeah, I would say that, you know, the first thing that sticks out, this right to bodily autonomy, I believe in it more than I would argue even a lot of pro-choice feminists do, because I believe you should have the right to have your body protected from violence from the moment it first exists. But we do have to acknowledge this is a unique situation. It's not her body, her choice, you know, that lacks the scientific depth it needs. It is an individual's body inside of another individual's body. And that's a very unique situation in coupling. And we have to acknowledge that. So making sure that we are protecting both lives, fighting for both lives. And in the feminist movement, you have people very vocal for women. In the pro-life movement, you have people very vocal for the unborn child. But I do think that's the beauty of pro-life feminism and the consistent life ethic, is we have to be fighting not 50%, 50, but, you know, or even 49, 51, which we kind of see a lot, even in the pro-life movement, but 100%, because this is two different individuals who are oftentimes vulnerable when it comes to unintended pregnancies. And we have to be fighting for both of them on, you know, socioeconomic levels, community levels, and political levels, obviously.
Thanks so much for that. Erica, what's your perspective on that question?
Yeah, so I take a lot of pages in a book to describe where we've really gone wrong. I mean, the first thing to point to, you know, I totally agree with everything Destiny has said, and really her mouth could have been, you know, speaking just Victoria Woodhill's words. She was the first woman to run for president, the first woman to testify before Congress, a really avid advocate for constitutional equality for women. This is in the mid 1800s. And, you know, she very much stated that the rights of children begin while yet they remain the fetus. And they were, those earliest women's rights advocates were all pro-life. And so the question is, why would that be the case? And just to get really at the nub of the thing is that they understood really well that there's this basic asymmetrical consequences when it comes to sex. Men and women engage in the same sexual act, but it is women's bodies who can bear children. So men can get up and literally walk away from an unexpected pregnancy. But a woman's body, she's not autonomous when it comes to pregnancy. She is actually caring for another human being in her womb. And so when we think about bodily autonomy as the ability to kind of do away with this child in the womb, we're thinking in very male-oriented way. It comes right out of Enlightenment thinking from John Locke, this idea of the child as property that I can kind of dispense with. It's incredibly male-oriented. The way the earliest women's rights advocates thought about it is that I have these affirmative duties of care to my child, and therefore the man who impregnated me also has duties of care to the child. So instead of thinking of equality as something that we, you know, we basically say we can reach equality by imitating men and their autonomy and their ability to walk away, we say we can reach equality by having men imitate women and they're being encumbered to and having obligations to their dependents. And that's really the way forward for an authentic dignitarian, communitarian, solidaristic feminism.
Thanks for that. Dan, I'd like to go to you on this issue a little bit with a little bit of a different perspective. We see a lot of very strong disagreement among people on this particular issue in particular, right? That there's this conflict of very basic priorities. I wonder if you can talk a little bit about how we might work to engage and persuade people on opposite sides of the issue. Is that a possibility here? Is there some way that we should all be thinking about a change in our approach on this issue from whatever side you approach this issue? I think of the work of people like Trisha Bruce as to the fact that this issue is a lot more complicated than maybe the binary that we often see in public life may portray it. What's your reaction to all that?
I think we can talk across the divide and depoliticize this issue, or at least turn the political heat down a bit. Some of what Destiny and Erica were saying, as well as things that Gloria said earlier, I think suggest ways that we can perhaps show those who are very skeptical of the pro-life movement that the pro-life movement is not necessarily making the sort of simplistic partisan arguments that they might associate with it. But in order to really do that effectively, I suspect that what we're going to have to do is move toward a post-partisan pro-life movement, which unfortunately is not occurring right now to a large degree. There are pockets of a post-partisan pro-life movement, and I would say that this Zoom session is one of those pockets. But I think that in general, when most people outside of the pro-life movement, and to a certain extent, even those inside the pro-life movement, think of the pro-life movement today, the first thing that they think of is something that's associated with a particular political party and a fairly narrow political agenda. And as long as that's the case, it's going to be very difficult to convince people that view a particular political ideology or particular political party as dangerous, which according to public opinion polls is happening, where people really do have these heightened senses that the other political party is not just suggesting a less viable strategy or a few policies that we wouldn't prefer, but is really a fundamental threat to the republic. And whether that impression is right or wrong, as long as that impression exists, it's going to be very difficult to bridge a partisan divide with a pro-life message. And so I think in this polarized political climate, the best thing that we can do in the pro-life movement is to try to find one area of agreement with people on the other side of the political aisle, whatever that other side might be, and to highlight the work of pro-lifers who might be outside of the partisan norm, and suggest that this is not a partisan message. This is a movement that predates our modern political polarization. And that, yes, the pro-life movement probably did contribute to this political polarization with a particular judicial strategy that was pursued at the cost of nearly everything else. But in spite of that, there's still something really valuable about the pro-life movement's history. And it's the things that it has historically stood for. And if we can present that message, I think it will go a long way. And of course, listening to people with whom we disagree, listening always, of course, helps a great deal.
Thanks so much for that. And I really want to highlight something maybe that I could pull out of that, which is that anybody who's worked around the pro-life movement or pro-life efforts for any amount of time knows that there are so many people who work on the ground day in and day out offering support to women in need and really are the heart and soul and the real witness of the pro-life movement. And I think, Gloria, maybe our last question go to you. I hope everybody will be patient and give us a couple extra minutes on here because we've had such a good conversation. Maybe our last question to you, and then we'll go around the horn one more time. But how can we raise up the work of people like that so that it reaches the political world, reaches the policy world? What might a consistent ethic post-partisan movement look like? How can we get to from witness on the ground to policy making? What's your thoughts?
Oh, I think that someone that calls himself pro-life can't take for granted that they'll have the support of the movement, or that we are going to, by and large, say one party is more godlike than the other, you know, or say things like you can't be a Catholic and this particular party. Those kinds of things would evaporate, would disappear, because they'd be nonsensical to those of us in the movement, because it's a language contrary to what we believe in the movement, because we have a movement that is a consistent ethic of life. And so we're going to be looking at our politicians to see, well, where do they stand on all of these things? Yeah, okay, you defend life in the womb. What about life outside the womb? You want to defend life outside the womb? What about life in the womb? We have no permanent friends or permanent enemies, just permanent issues that we'll be putting through our sieve, if you will, when we deal with politicians, and they'll see that. So I think that postpartisan consistent ethic world will be those of us consistently making demands for greater love, basically. And we won't be satisfied until we are arrived, that everybody is accounted for and loved in our community. And so that's what it's going to look like. Hopefully people hear this and they're not tired, but energized, that we're just always inviting people to love more, to do more, because we can, and because we're animated here to do that. We want a thriving community. And I also want people to say that includes looking at business, that includes looking at military, and that includes looking at education. How are these environments conducive to women who are pregnant, mothering, nursing, just everything along our lifespan? So we have a lot more questions to ask.
Thank you for that positive and forward-looking vision. And now, so we don't try everybody's patience, but this has been such a wonderful conversation. I want to have one last question for all of you. If you could give us the one thing that you want viewers to take away from our conversation here today. And Erica, let's start with you.
Yeah, I guess I would just say, as we hopefully move beyond kind of the Roe era in our nation's history and the history of kind of the pro-life movement, I really hope we can kind of look back to our forebears in the 19th century women's rights movement, because like the progressives that, you know, Dan talks about in his book, I think these women really have a lot to teach us. Just a word that they really knew that the advancement of women would only be really, truly, authentically possible if the country understood these women's obligation to their children, both born and unborn, and worked really to support those obligations.
Thank you. How about you, Destiny? What do you think is the one takeaway you'd like people to take away from our...
I would say that, you know, voting is your civic duty, but honestly, when it comes to being pro-life, it's probably the laziest form of activism. It is, I know as a nation, politics has become like our national religion and hobby. Just people are so passionate about it and want to talk about it. But if that energy can be reallocated to looking at how individualistic your community has gotten and where you can play a role in helping your neighbor, the person down the street, the young girl in your community who needs to study for her midterms, and you can offer a few hours of babysitting. I mean, these are the things that are pro-life as a verb, beyond just a bumper sticker and voting a particular way and labeling yourself that. Like, pro-life needs to be an action that is actually stepping up and changing these systems, these patriarchal structures that were not built for women or by women and don't really accommodate women. So we have to be the change in that. We have to be the ones stepping up to do that. And it goes well beyond the ballot box.
And wouldn't that be wonderful if we were part of the energy behind changing these kinds of structures that you talk about? Dan, how about you? What do you think is what you would like viewers to walk away from this conversation understanding?
I hope that they would walk away with a sense of hope that there are many people out there that understand that the pro-life movement is about so much more than simply what often makes the headlines. And I think as we've listened to Erica described some of the philosophical basis for this movement that goes back long before our current partisan divisions, as we've heard Destiny tell her story, as we've heard Gloria talk about what a more comprehensive social justice vision of the movement would look like and how to apply that on the ground. I would hope that people realize that there are a lot of thoughtful pro-life activists out there. And there are a lot of people who genuinely care about a broader social justice vision. And even if in the end, you know, a few of us don't always agree entirely on political choices in a very difficult partisan environment in which there are no perfect choices on the ballot, I think that we can take hope in this unity around some really important foundational principles that I hope will be preserved.
Thanks, Dan. Gloria, let's round it out with you. What do you think viewers should walk away from our conversation with? And also, I'd like to say, what do you think the Catholic community should walk away with? How should we be responding at this moment?
Well, I hope our viewers are understanding that to be for racial justice doesn't mean you can't be also pro-life and vice versa. Again, they're both movements centering on the dignity of the human person. And I hope the Catholics, because that's so central to our belief about the human person, don't fear either movement and see themselves as being able to be a part of both in how they think, act, and contribute to our greater community. I think a large part of it as well is rejecting the sort of like my individual liberty is the most important thing and my individual comfort is the most important thing, because as people of faith, we understand our salvation was brought about by Christ embracing the cross. And so we too need to embrace the cross in terms of being able to follow his steps and bring about a more just world, which sometimes means we have to sacrifice for the benefit of those who have less. So love more. I hope that's what people get from this.
Love more. That is a wonderful way to end this conversation. And I want to thank you all. I want to thank you, Erica, Destiny, Gloria, and Dan. Thank all of you who joined us for this important conversation. Just want to remind you that this discussion will be recorded and posted on our website and social channels, and we'll have follow-up resources from the discussion posted there too. This is our first dialogue of 2022, but we have many more on the way, and we have some planned in the coming weeks, including an online conference this Thursday, January 20th, that we're co-sponsoring with the Berkeley Center on Clergy Sexual Abuse in the Catholic Church, Listening to the Voices of Survivors. My colleague John Carr and I will both be participating in this important event, and we hope you can join us. On Tuesday, February 1st, we're holding a major online dialogue on faith, politics, and policy in 2022. What is a faithful agenda now? And we'll have Angela Espada, who is the executive director of the Indiana Catholic Conference, Ruth Graham, national correspondent covering religion, faith, and values for the New York Times, Reverend Alvin Herring, the executive director of Faith in Action, and Russell Moore, the director of the Public Theology Project at Christianity Today, as well as our colleague, Reverend Jim Wallace, who's the leader of the Center on Faith and Justice in the McCourt School of Public Policy here at Georgetown. So please visit our website for updates on these and other gatherings later this semester. Thank you to my colleagues, John Carr and Anna Gordon, for all their help putting this dialogue together. And finally, please join me in thanking Erica Bacchiocchi, Destiny Herndon-De La Rosa, Gloria Purvis, and Dan Williams for being a part of this public dialogue on the pro-life movement at a crossroads, Dobbs in a divided society. Thank you, and we look forward to having you join us again.